I have three pieces of paper that are coming around that I think will help you as we move through, coming left to right, as we move through some things. And I'm going to talk, obviously, about the budget, but put budget in perspective. I'm going to talk a little bit about what happened last year. I'm going to talk about what's going on right now, and I'm going to talk about what we're aiming for next year. And at the end of that, hopefully, you'll have some clarity. And hopefully and ideally, for those of you, and I'm sure everyone in this room, is a believer of the role of public higher education in this state, hopefully you will join with me for the next 2 days and try to help us move toward the finish line in a positive way. So as I said, I started last year, January 2nd, and I sort of joked, I had a 2-hour honeymoon before the budget crisis of last year hit. And again, to put it in perspective, last year was the year 2015. 5 years prior to that, the budget for higher education was about $1.5 billion. I'm going to give you specifics on that sheet, but I'm just talking now in general terms. The budget for higher education was about $1.5 billion 5 years prior to last year. It had been winnowed away, basically cut in half every year by 50%. So the budget that I started the year was $750 million, one half of what it had been 5 years prior. And that's the money that we allocate to all the campuses, all the systems, and all the institutions in the state. We were facing at that time, in that legislative session, an additional 82% budget cut. 82% budget cut, which we fought against for the entire legislative session. But it was not until the last hour of the last day of the session, through the SAVE Act, through the magic of the SAVE Act, and I won't go through the magic of the SAVE Act, that we were able basically to not recognize any loss. But we knew it was artificial. So this fall, what we started to do is we brought together stakeholder groups, because I knew and we all knew that unless business and higher ed and nonprofits and a lot of the folks that depend upon our graduates got together and started to work towards some outcomes that were positive, we were going to have some disagreements. So we worked, brought together all sorts of groups, Lobby, GNO, Inc., obviously all the system presidents, our regents, and one of our regents, Regent Joe Wiley, is here today, all came together. And we met over the course of the fall, and we crafted basically a brand for higher ed. Now, I'm a former business dean, a former business professor, and there's nothing wrong with marketing. We did not have a brand for higher ed. So you can see the first piece of paper there you have. The brand that we came up with is we wanted something that was aspirational, we wanted something that was sustainable, something that would hold us accountable. And you will see Elevate Louisiana. Elevate Louisiana is the aspirational brand, if you will, for higher education in this state. And there are a couple of things on that sheet, and again, they all sort of come back to the budget, a couple of things on that sheet that are important. On the left-hand side, you'll see Educate, and on the right-hand side, you'll see Innovate. Under Educate, the first thing we wanted to do was to make sure that we started with the senior year in high school and created a continuum of education all the way through credentials, 2-year, 4-year, all the way to the post-secondary, so that every one of our institutions is on that line somewhere. Because I wanted to avoid this notion that workforce is out there and higher ed is over here. So the first thing you'll see is that basically everyone has a place on that continuum going from the senior year in high school. The second thing we saw on the right-hand side is Innovate. We are really looking at Louisiana's maturing as a state in terms of the intellectual property from our faculty and commercialization, technology transfer. We have a long way to go, even with the flagship. But innovation allows us to use that intellectual capital to attract new businesses and to keep the businesses that are here. So Elevate Louisiana is something you'll begin to see and will see downstream in terms of our branding. Now let me talk about where we are right now in terms of the budget. Now I'd like you to take a look right now at the, it says Louisiana Higher Education, the True Picture. You know, there are a couple of myths that I want to dispel right off the bat. The first myth is that Louisiana, basically the colleges and universities have received state funds over cuts over the years, but tuition and fee revenue have more than made up for those cuts. So let's take a look at this sheet of paper, and we'll walk you through it, and this is a public document, it's the one I use all the time. But there's some really very interesting things there I'd like you to look at. We're comparing two fiscal years, one from 08-09, the one I mentioned 5-6 years ago, to 15-16, which is where we are now. So if you start at the top, you'll see fiscal year 08-09, total state funds, that's the amount of money we get from the state, what's called general fund, was about $1.5 billion. That was the number I told you a little while ago. And if you read to the right, you'll see self-generated funds. Self-generated funds are really tuition dollars that the students pay. And then you'll see some funds and transfers. And you'll see a total budget of about $2.4 billion. Go down the line below that, and I'm going to come back to that in a minute, but you'll see mandated costs back to the state. In other words, out of the money that we get from the state, we return money back to the state to pay for a variety of activities. I'll come back to that in a second. So if you look then at for dollars available for operations in 08-09, it was about $1.8 billion. Remember, the myth I'm looking at right now is that tuition and fee increases have more than offset anything, any loss. Go to fiscal year 15. Total state funds, $887 million. Compare that to the 1.5 above that. That shows a 44% reduction in the amount of money the state has given to public higher education. And if you go over to the next line, it says self-generated funds, remember that's tuition. That's $1.3 billion. Compare that to the $721 million. What that shows you is that as the state money has gone down, the need for our students to pay has gone up. So Louisiana has gone from a relatively affordable public higher education system to one that is now oftentimes out of reach of their of the students. And read across, and you'll see about $2.2 billion. And go to the line below that, unfunded mandates, the mandated costs. Remember they were basically $443 million the year 5 years ago? Now they're at $560 million. What that means is that for every dollar you get in that first column, in the total state funds, for every dollar that we get, our campuses give back an average of 63 cents on the dollar back to the state for services. That means only 37 cents of every dollar can be used to educate our students. There are some campuses that give back more than 63. One campus gives back $1.13. They actually have to pay 13 cents more back to the state than they get. And where do those costs go for? Well, look at the second sheet of paper. This is what's called higher education mandated costs. We pay for a variety of things: risk management, we pay for civil service, we pay for auditors, we pay for pension plans. And none of us minds paying for pension plans, that's a retirement cost. But look at the line in the bottom, the very bottom. We also pay $83 million a year out of the money that we get back to the state to support K through 12 retirement plans. These are the types of things that take away money from the classroom. These are the types of things that take away the ability, oftentimes, to offset some of the, if you will, cuts. So let me talk about this year. We are in a special session, I think everybody recognizes, and that's going to be over on Wednesday. And because of the Louisiana Constitution, you cannot discuss fiscal issues this year in the regular session, which starts a couple of days after the special, unless those have been identified in the special session. So right now what you're looking at are revenue generation and budget cuts for this year, from now to the end of the semester, at the end of the year, and next year. So let's talk about each of those years separately. Let's talk about this year. Now today is what? Today is March 7th. This has only been 3 weeks that this has been going on. On February 10th, I received a letter. All this is on our website. If you go to the Board of Regents website, you'll see everything that I'm talking about. I believe in transparency. On February 10th, I received a letter from Commissioner Jay Darden, who's the governor's budget person, saying, you need to prepare for a minimum $42 million reduction up to a maximum of $131 million from now until the end of the fiscal year, which is June 30th. Then the next day I met with the governor and Jay Darden, and basically they said, okay, normally a supplemental bill will go through to add exactly what it says, supplement the original revenue. They're not going to do a supplemental bill this year. And in that supplemental bill was an additional $28 million for TOPS. So at that meeting, in addition to the $42 million that we were told we would have to absorb, they added $28 million on. So the best case, and I use that word very, very loosely, the best case for higher ed between now and the end of this end of June is $70 million. And then it went up from there to 131, 132, 140. So this is what has basically engendered a lot of the comments in the newspaper about what will happen if this comes to pass. And I'm going to come back to that in a second. But let me go to the next fiscal year. Remember, I said there's 2 years we're talking about right now. The first year is from here till the end of June. And remember, classes have started. We don't have much going on out there. Most costs are associated with faculty and staff salaries, but we have to give back a minimum of $70 million. And the way that's done is that every month, the institutions draw $42 million from the state. And that $42 million simply will not be given. So put it in your perspective. If you're expecting your paycheck to come at the end of the month and there is no paycheck, what do you do? And if next year is going to be better than this year, then presidents will make decisions this year. Perhaps you'll furlough rather than lay off. So we have to basically think about next year really as part of this year's budget. And sadly to say, next year doesn't look very good at all. In fact, I found this little quote from John Stewart that I think is a sort of sets the stage. He said, if con is the opposite of pro, then isn't Congress the opposite of progress? Put that in our state legislature. So let's talk about next year. Next year starts July 1. Okay. There are two numbers I'd like you to think about for next year. The budget deficit, we don't know where that's going to be, and that's not the number I'm going to use. I'm going to give you two numbers. Right now, 27% reduction in the higher ed budget for next year. That's what we're starting the year off with, 27% reduction. And the second number I want you to think about is 80%. TOPS will be reduced by 80%. Now let me talk a little bit about that, because that's the one that a lot of people are really concerned about. Because for many people in this state, TOPS has become the savings account for college. If you get a certain GPA, certain ACT, you have TOPS. TOPS is funded in two ways. The first is interest generated by tobacco settlement from years ago. That's about $65 million a year. And the rest comes out of that general fund, that same fund that I showed you. And so the governor's budget right now has $0 from the general fund. There will be about $65 million for TOPS available for next year. What does that mean? Well, a lot of people say, well, okay, if you're going to take an 80% reduction, that means instead of getting a dollar, I'll get 20 cents. That's not the way it works. What happens is, according to the rules, procedures, you have to lop off categories of students by GPA and ACT, and you have to keep rolling them up from bottom to top until you achieve the number of students that qualify for the amount of money. So this year, there's about 45,000 students on TOPS. Next year, with these numbers, there'll be less than 9,000. And right now, you can get a full TOPS four-year tuition ride for an ACT of 20. Under the new scenario, it will be a minimum of 27. That includes the students who are currently on TOPS, as well as the students who are in high school. So where are we? Where are we right now? Remember what I said, the best case scenario was 70 million, and the worst case scenario was about 130 some odd. Well, as of this morning, just walking out, and again, what they're debating right now in the legislature, that 70 now has gone to 86.8. And so you will see on our webpage that if that 86.8 holds, and will hold unless something is done in the next 2 days, then you will see a whole variety of things begin to occur. And I'm just quoting a few of those. LSU Health Science Center in Shreveport will not be able to make payroll in June. At LSU, the flagship here, they already see student registration in their orientation programs for next fall. You know, students who have choices may choose to go elsewhere. Their student enrollments for next fall are down 15% for next year because of the uncertainty over the budget. Grambling will make personnel cuts, but most significantly, the university will have difficulty meeting its cash flow, i.e. payroll. Louisiana Tech and Southeastern furloughs and layoffs, and the inability to have summer school. UNO layoffs, exigency may be inevitable, and LCTCS will drastically reduce the number of its employees. So I don't mean to be a pessimist. I'm an optimistic person. I really am. But I'm also a frank person. I'm saying right now, and I'll close here, be happy to answer any questions. The reality is that nothing has changed in higher education. The reason why healthcare and higher ed have to undergo these drastic cuts every year is because they are not statutorily protected. So last year when the session was over, nothing changed. This year during the special session, nothing has changed. We are still unprotected. It's the only place you can go to try to balance the budget. And although we have a lot of legislative friends, and as you can read the paper the same way that I read the paper, there's also a lot of opposition, whether it's from municipalities or some of the business groups, some of the others. Let me leave you with another figure that I always like to use, and again, I'm not taking a position on it, but I'm always saying, If higher education, public higher education, is indeed a priority or the priority for this state, as many people have indicated, then let me give you another set of numbers. The state gives approximately $3,000 per student, per university student. $3,000 roughly comes from the state budget to support a student. That's way down from what it was a few years ago, but anyway, $3,000. If you are an incarcerated adult, that number is $16,000. And if you are an incarcerated youth, that number is over $32,000. And as I've indicated, and I'll stop here and answer questions, I say I do not believe that business and industry comes to this state because we have the highest incarceration rate in the country. I believe they come here because we have a talented and educated workforce that can basically meet their needs. And if these budget cuts continue, that is in jeopardy. So, happy to answer any questions.
Well, my message here today is that higher education is in dire straits at this point in time, with 2 days left to develop the budget for the rest of this year and for next year. We need support to make sure that we can continue doing what we're supposed to be doing.
As it stands right now, if there's no changes, what would happen in terms of funding for higher education and for TOPS?
Well, basically, for the rest of this year, we will start seeing classes canceled, people laid off because of the inability to basically make payroll. For next year, what we're looking at is an 80% reduction in TOPS. That means instead of 45,000 students being TOPS eligible, it'll be about 9,000.
And how will that affect the eligibility for TOPS?
The eligibility for TOPS will not change. It stays the same. What changes is the process by which limited dollars are allocated. So that means that instead of having a 20 ACT and you basically get a TOPS, now that'll probably be about a 27 ACT.
And what kind of an impact is this having on student enrollment at the universities across the state?
Well, they haven't started to enroll yet, but we do know, for example, LSU, the flagship institution, has orientation for students, potential freshmen, and they're down by 15% already because of the uncertainty that students see out there.
What about the impact for faculty?
I already know faculty are both leaving, and also faculty who they're trying to recruit are not coming here. There's no question about that.
What would you like to see happen?
Well, what I would like to see happen is a recognition of the value of public higher education to the state. It's not just a private good, it's a public good. And so therefore the recognition is that public good requires resources, and to take the cuts that they're looking at from now to the end of the year simply is not possible.
How does the cuts to higher education in Louisiana compare to budget situations at universities throughout the country?
Well, since 2008, the Great Recession, almost every other state has bounced back. Louisiana has not bounced back, and so therefore we are the poster child, if you will. We have the largest net decrease in state support of any other state in the country.
If people have questions like more information about higher education budgeting, what should they do?
They just go to the Board of Regents website. So it's boardofregents.la.gov. We have everything I've talked about today, as well as some suggestions. If you believe that higher ed is important, gives you some talking points for your legislators or for some of the parents to talk about things that help us out.